seniors and a junior stepping in for the injured Kenny Hayes will be the senior guard, a 5'9 man, Carl Richburg. For West Virginia, back into the starting lineup, Alex Ruoff. We talked about the injury that he had. He had a shoulder issue as well as some problem with his ribs, but he's back in today and taking over for Joe Mazzulla in the starting lineup will be Truck Bryant, the freshman. Just about set for tip-off here inside the WVU Coliseum. It'll be Adam Fletcher for the Red Hawks and Wellington Smith for the Mountaineers.
Well, right off the bat for West Virginia, Devin Ebanks, the 6'9 phenomenal freshman, is not playing due to an ankle injury yesterday. Here's a guy who had 44 rebounds over his past three games. That could hurt them down low.
See Richburg with the ball now, running the point inside. Good move up and blocked away by Butler. Fletcher had the dunk, but knocked away. Truck Bryant back the other way for the Mountaineers.
Well, I like the patience of Miami, Ohio so far. They came out, they run their sets. They're going to utilize the entire shot clock, really try to make West Virginia be impatient.
Miami, Ohio starting with the man-to-man, and that's something that we asked head coach Charlie Coles about yesterday in shoot-around. Thought he might go for the zone. Three-point shot short by Butler, picked up underneath by Wellington Smith, and the offensive rebounding, Jay, was definitely a concern for Coach Coles yesterday when we talked to him.
Well, it was. He spoke about it, and, you know, for West Virginia, they're exceptional in the glass. They have over 40.3 rebounds per game, and they out-rebound their opponents by 11. Now, you talk about for Miami, they need the rebound. They've been just barely equal rebounding their opponents each game, whereas West Virginia dominates the boards.
Ball knocked away by Bryant. Another turnover for the Red Hawks. Ruoff kicks it back out. Bryant thought about a three. He's going to reset the offense for West Virginia.
Well, I like the experience right there. Truck Bryant, freshman point guard from the Bronx, St. Raymond's, all-time leading scorer. But having a little bit difficult time adjusting to running the sets and all the plays for this West Virginia team. One of the keys for them, Steve, is they need leadership. You know, talk about last year after losing Joe Alexander, who was the emotional leader for this team. Bobby Huggins really has some concerns. Who is going to be the leader of his team day in and day out?
Early foul on Michael Bramos, his first and team's first. That's not the guy that Miami, Ohio wants to get into foul trouble. First shot in three games for Alex Ruoff, short, and it goes out of bounds. And take a look at the head coaches for these two teams. Of course, for the Mountaineers, head coach Bobby Huggins. A win today ties him with Norm Sloan, the late great NC State coach, the 28th all-time. Also fourth on the all-time list among active head coaches in wins. Inside Fletcher, and he's going to get called for the travel.
Well, for Bobby, has to be a great thing, you know, born and raised here in Morgantown.
For Miami, Ohio, Coach Coles, see the 213 wins. He's four away from taking over the record for Miami, Ohio wins in program history.
1965 graduate from Miami, Ohio.
Bryant's first shot goes. The three ball is good. 5-0 start for the Mountaineers.
Well, I think this is the kind of start that Truck Bryant needs his game. He's one of those kids, when he comes out, when he scores his first couple possessions, he starts to play with confidence. He starts to find people in the perimeter, making everybody around him better.
Curious to see who is going to cover Bramos for West Virginia. And right now, it's Wellington Smith on the right side of the court. Pollitz with the ball now. Twin brother Tim graduated last year. Eric redshirted his freshman year. That's why he is a fifth-year senior. Bramos from way outside long. Offensive rebound by Pollitz, though.
Well, those are the situations we were talking about right there where they could struggle. Kenny Hayes did a great job of, whoa, great pass right there by Richmond.
Found Fletcher down low. Good look.
But Kenny Hayes did a great job when the shot clock dwindled down to 10-9. He was able to create. Now you talk about guys on the team have to create shots, you know, for Bramos and some of these other guys to knock down perimeter Jays.
Ryan again at the top of the key looking for Ruoff. Butler tries to take it himself. Ruoff wide open in the corner, long. A little rusty to start after missing the first two games for Alex.
Well, he has. He's been a little out. And, you know, for any player, when you miss two games, getting your breathing pattern down and trying to get your excitement level to a low-key minimum is a key for him to come out in his first game.
Richburg strong to the hole, draws the foul. It's a good look here by Richburg.
You see the great pass, and those are the kind of situations they need to find themselves in. Richburg needs to make plays like that. When the shot clock dwindles down, he needs to find guys for backdoor cuts. I think West Virginia, due to their style that Bobby Huggins implements into their play, they really pressure the wings. They try to get in your face defensively. And I think they're really susceptible to backdoor cuts. And that's the style that Miami plays.
Foul was on Wellington Smith, his first, the team's second. Richburg at the line. Took over for Kenny Hayes as the second free throw falls down. Took over for Kenny Hayes 2 games ago when he couldn't play initially with that wrist injury. Had a career-high 14 points against Wisconsin-Milwaukee.
Well, I like his energy so far. You talk about he was only averaging nine minutes a game.
Bryant again from three. 2 for 2 to start the game from beyond the arc for Truck.
Well, yesterday I asked him, I was like, why did they call you Truck? He's like, Jay, you know, I was born in the Bronx and, you know, playing basketball on Coney Island, I used to run people over. And he started calling me Truck. I ran people over, that's what I do.
Ramos trying to create, knocked away though by Flowers, and quickly back the other way is Bryant. Look to Butler, up and good, count it and the foul.
And that's where West Virginia is very dangerous, attacking in transition. Bryant does a great job of pushing the ball, pushing it with his head up, and finding Mr. Butler for the and-one feed.
Takes us to our first timeout. West Virginia up 6, just under 16 minutes to play. It's on you, but we'll see what happens today.
Well, speaking of your school, I mean, you guys got a new coach. Marone comes in, you know, offensive coordinator for the Saints. Going to step it up for you guys a little bit, get you guys back on track.
Very excited to have an alum on campus back in on the sidelines for Syracuse football. Back underway here in the Coliseum. Sean Butler's free throw is no good, and the and-one opportunity goes begging. Backdoor cut for Bramos, though, knocked away from behind by Ruoff, though, out of bounds, and Red Hawks will keep possession.
Yeah, I think Bobby Huggins is a little frustrated right there. You saw that. Sometimes when they play that style of defense, they can overexert themselves a little bit, and they're really susceptible to backdoor cuts. And that's what Miami's going to do this entire game. They're going to try to make it mentally break down defensively and take advantage of it and capitalize.
Fletcher again on the offensive end, and that's 4 points for him in the early going. Surprising considering he's only averaging about 2 per game this year and came into this game only shooting 23%.
Well, coach put him in the game due to his physical presence. He thinks he can help them out rebounding against WVU.
There is Rulon, third three-point attempt falls down, and that is his specialty. Leading scorer for the Mountaineers, averaging 14 per game, coming into this one, shooting 37% from beyond the arc.
Well, in their big games against Ole Miss and Kentucky, he really struggled from the three-point line. He's one of those outside-in players. Once he gets his shot going, then all of a sudden he'll find a mid-range jump shot. But I really like his aggressiveness to come out. You have to think how he's taking on the leadership role of this team. You know, now that Joe Alexander is out, you know, he's trying to be more vocal. He's trying to be an extension of Bobby Huggins on the court. So there's a lot of new responsibilities that he has to worry about instead of just shooting the basketball now.
Sean Butler gets called for the foul, his first. See Durkers at the top of the key, more of the forward slash centers. Paulitz now from outside, a little short. Smith with the rebound. We weren't sure really who was going to run the point today without Missoula, as there's another foul on the floor. So far, it's pretty much been Truck Bryant, the freshman for the Mountaineers.
Well, I think what you just saw Bryant do in that last possession is what makes him special. Even though he's 6'1", he's around 200 pounds. And when he puts that shoulder down, he wants to attack the basket. There is no stopping.
A little bit long on that three-point attempt. The outlet goes to Richburg, a little bit out of control, but Paulitz back the other way, gets it, draws the foul, and he will go to the line.
Well, that was a little bit out of control, but that was controlled chaos. How about Richburg to have the mental awareness to make that one-handed push pass? Right there, you see he gets the ball here, one-handed push pass. Little Steve Nash. Little Steve Nash for you, little
dangle. Court vision, very good court vision from the senior. And Coach Cole's talking to him and Fletcher on the sideline. Richburg again into the starting lineup. First free throw for Paulitz falls. Into the starting lineup for Kenny Hayes, who's really just been the guy who has led this team at the point, has kind of been the duo behind the arc as far as sharpshooting is concerned with Michael Bramo. Second free throw, good.
Well, talk about the two of those guys together, especially with Kenny Hayes' ability to penetrate and to create opportunities for other players. He's also shooting around 45% from the three-point line, so they missed that extra attacker on the wing.
Ruoff again in the corner with a hand in his face, a little bit short, but gets the offensive rebound, finds Flowers underneath, and that's just good hustle by Ruoff following his shot.
Well, I think that's another thing that Rudolph is great at doing. You talk about career passing. You know, he has over 314 assists in his career. But horrible shot there in the corner. I'd love to see him attack the basket. Being 6'5", 210, he should use that frame and get to the rim.
Ramos gets free on the outside. A little bit short, though, and that's his specialty. He's going to keep shooting. Head coach Charlie Cole says he has free reign, but the other way, Wellington Smith knocks it down. And a 30-second timeout for Coach Coles and the Redhawks.
Well, if you're Miami of Ohio, you have to be worried about getting back in transition. After Ramos took that shot, West Virginia did a great job of getting the ball out, pushing it down the court, finding, and most of their guys in the wing are ready to shoot the ball. Guys like Rudolph and Butler, they're ready to shoot the ball all times. They caught the ball in the wing and knocked it down.
Michael Bramos for Miami, Ohio to start the game 0 for 3 from the field. Not exactly the same case for WVU's been heating up from outside today so far.
Well, they've been able to attack the rim, and when they attack the rim, it leaves out open opportunities for guys to shoot the ball. You know, you're seeing right here, Chuck Bryant kind of finding his rhythm, getting into a flow offensively. And then Rudolph comes off the screen, and that's what great shooters do. When you have a hand down, you cannot approach a shooter with a hand down. We have a hand down, I'm looking to shoot the ball automatically. And that's what Rudolph and Chuck Bryant are doing this entire first half.
You see the stats for today from beyond the arc, well above their season average, at least here in the early going. And that's a problem that Miami's going to have on the defensive end. You know, Rudolph can shoot the three, but there's a plethora of other players on this Mountaineer team that can shoot the ball as well. A little bit easier for West Virginia. You can key on Ramos without Kenny Hayes on the court. Ramos shooting over 50% from beyond the arc this year, seventh in the country. Richburg, nice drive. Left hand a little bit short, though. Missed the left. Gets it back, though, and saves it.
Well, you have to love the energy by Richburg right now. You know he's not the star stud that Kenny Hayes was, but he's going to bring that excitement and energy to the table every possession.
Knocked out of bounds, and Coach Huggins wanted it the other way, but it'll stay Red Hawks ball. Richburg, a guy who started the first three games of his sophomore year, but an ankle injury and a shoulder injury later on in the year kind of made him lose his starting spot. It was the same for his junior year last year, but has two starts this year. We mentioned the career high against Wisconsin-Milwaukee and a very good start today in the starting lineup for the senior.
Well, Bramos is 0 for 3. And talk about the last game, you know, versus Pitt, he was 0 for 6 from the field goal, regular two-point field goals, and then 0 from 3 from three-point range. So if he does not get going, this team is in deep trouble.
4 seconds to shoot. Richburg's going to take it to the hole. Bramos with one on the shot clock, in and out.
Still great penetration by Richburg to get in there. He had a chance to finish, but he found his star and gave his star a chance to get a bucket.
Bryant strong in the hole, almost gets the crazy shot to fall out of bounds, and it'll go back to Miami, Ohio. That makes Bramos on that last possession 0 for 4 now from the floor.
Well, and that's one of the situations we talk about for Daryl Bryant. I really like to see him get other people involved more when he comes out. He's a point guard now for a Big East team that has a chance to be special. If he can get people involved quickly, it'll give him more opportunities to score offensively later in the game.
Good defense from West Virginia. Rudolph back the other way, pulls up, knocks it down, and gives the student section a little stare and says, hey, I'm back.
Hey, listen, he's hot. When we see Alex Rudolph, one of the best shooters in the country, I don't care if he has the ball in transition or if he has the ball just catching it and waiting on the wing. You have to get a hand up and be ready to contest his shot.
Richburg trying to create, somehow finds Paul's back up top, and Bramos about 30 feet away from the bucket. West Virginia on a 7-0 run. The Redhawks trying to stop that right now. Underneath is Durkers, finds Bramos back to Richburg on the left wing, and in and out, no good. Offensive rebound, though, and Fletcher again. 6 points for Fletcher in the early going. Well, a lot better than that 23% field goal percentage he had coming into this game, huh, Jay?
Well, I asked Cole yesterday, are you really going to play Fletcher? And he said, Jason, absolutely right. This is a kid that's going to give us physical presence down low, and he's not afraid to bang. He's going to bang everybody every possession.
West Virginia up 10, and a travel by Rudolph. 20-10 West Virginia, shooting the lights out from beyond the arc. Truck Bryant on that one. About 12 minutes to go here in the early go. 20-10 West Virginia over Miami, Ohio. 11-12 to play in the first half. And You mentioned the three-point shooting, Jay, early in this game. You look at Alex Ruoff's numbers on the year, the leading scorer for the Mountaineers. Had that rib injury, also a little banged up with a shoulder. He had some treatment before the game to try and work it out, and it's going pretty well for him so far. 5 points, that last three that we saw before the break, his foot was on the line, so 5 points for him in the early going.
Well, he's always ready to shoot, and you talk about the only senior on the team with 8 freshmen and sophomores, so this is a big year for him. And Bobby Huggins, speaking about it yesterday, says, you know, Jay, Alex needs to be the leader of this team. He has experience, but he's always been a guy who's been playing off other great guys. He's had Deshaun Butler, he's had Joe Alexander. Now he's expected to find his shot, but also make everybody around him better, not just by his on-the-court play, but more importantly, by being a leader vocally.
Same starters into the game for Miami, Ohio, and Durkers is going to get caught for the travel back the other way for West Virginia. A couple subs into the game for the Mountaineers. The freshman, 6'9 freshman for Devin Ebanks into the game. He's usually a starter for West Virginia. He's a little bit banged up this week in practice.
He is. Well, you talk about he sprained his left ankle in practice 2 days ago. Then he jammed his knee the other day in practice. So, you know, as a freshman going through the trials of your freshman year, the bumps and the bruises. But I like his mentality because he's still playing and he's on the court. Speaking of freshmen.
And speaking of a sub, Kevin Jones knocks down the three. The freshman out of Mount Vernon, New York, another one of the highly touted recruits that Bob Huggins has brought in this year. Foot on the line, actually make that a two, but West Virginia with the number 4 recruiting class in the country this year. Ball goes out of bounds and another turnover for Miami, Ohio.
Well, that situation right there, which you saw Richburg get trapped, that just comes from experience. You know, Kenny Hayes, I'm sure as a point guard, you would never bring the ball over the court into one of those 4 corners that where you're more liable to get trapped. You bring the ball in the middle of the court, you keep yourself, and you keep your dribble alive in order to split through those tracks and create opportunities for other people.
The 3 freshmen on the court for West Virginia. Ebanks, who spots up from outside, a little bit long. Rebounded, though, by Butler. Goes up with it strong, a little bit too strong. Rebounded by Winbush, who's into the game for Miami, Ohio.
You got to think for Miami, Ohio so far, Fletcher is 3 of 4 on the field, and the rest of the team is 0 of 8.
Another turnover for Miami, Ohio. This is a team that doesn't turn over the ball that much. Alex Ruoff again a little bit long. Another rebound for Butler on the offensive end and puts it in.
When we said that West Virginia was a team that out-rebounded their opponents by plus 11. And that was one of the keys for Coach Coles coming into today's game. Will we be able to defensively buckle down and box out and stop them from getting second chance opportunities?
Head coach Charlie Coles told us yesterday that they got to control the ball. That ball's blocked away by Paul. It's 2 West Virginia players in on it. Ruoff back the other way. Takes off from the free throw line, gets it, and the foul.
And that's exactly what we're talking about Alex Ruoff needs to do. We all know he is a great outside shooter, but with his 6'5 height and his 220 frame, he should be able to attack the basket. You see it all start right here from the weak side help. Devin Ebanks coming over for the help. He's kind of grimacing through that ankle pain, but Alex Ruoff getting right here in the lane and having the ability to mentally stay strong and finish that play shows you he has a chance to be more than just an outside jump shooter.
Started to mention it before. Head coach Charlie Coles told us that they need to control the ball today, and that's surprising that they haven't as the free throw falls for Ruoff. 7 turnovers already in the first half, and this is a team that only averages a little more than 11. That's good so far for 7th in the nation for Miami, Ohio. So very uncharacteristic of this Red Hawks team. You got to attribute some of that to this very monotonous West Virginia defense.
Well, Kramer Saltenberg comes in the game for Miami, Ohio, running the point. And Chuck Bryant's eyes light up as he knows he can get him defensively.
Kramer Soderberg into the game and turns it over very quickly. Another freshman for this Red Hawks team. Ramos is having all kinds of trouble getting open from the outside.
Well, you saw Coach Coles right there telling Kramer to keep his dribble alive, and that's what West Virginia does exceptionally well. They crowd you defensively. Chuck Bryant, with that 6'1 height and his 200-pound frame, does a great job of getting into you defensively, really causing a lot of havoc. And you don't want to pick up your dribble. You want to keep your dribble alive the entire time.
Everybody moving off the ball for West Virginia as Ruoff tries to go in. Back out for Bryant from 3, gets it to fall, his third 3-point field goal in the first half.
Well, listen, yesterday we were in the court, and it's myself, Bryant, and Deshaun Butler, And Bryant beat me in a game of horse. He can flat out shoot the ball. It's all about him finding his comfort level. Once he finds his comfort level, now as a freshman, you're not only worried about your shot, but walking into the point guard responsibilities, you got to control the whole team instead of just worrying about yourself.
You saw the points off turnovers and quick foul on the play by Truck Bryant. 30-10 West Virginia lead, under 8 to play here. And it's been all Mountaineers in the early going. News presentation of Holiday Hoops presented by K Jewelers. 7:57 remaining in the first half. West Virginia with a 30-10 lead, and a lot of it, Jay, is because of three-point shooting from Truck Bryant, the freshman.
Well, Daryl Bryant has made a plethora of threes today, and he's found the rhythm. Yesterday, I saw him get a lot of jump shots after practice, and he always has his hands ready to shoot three or four from the field array. But the reason he's getting great shots is that West Virginia's doing a great job of penetrating and kicking. You've seen Alex Rudolph do that two times, driving the ball, and them having the awareness to get the ball out, swing it, and knock down the gym.
Backdoor cut from Bramos, kicks it back outside for the freshman Soderberg. Gets caught again in the lane. Into the game as well for Miami, Ohio, another freshman, number 4, Julian Mavunga.
The wingspan of the West Virginia players has to be frustrating for Miami, Ohio. Even when they penetrate, they still don't have a wide open jump shot like they like to get.
Two to shoot on the shot clock, and steps out of bounds this Kramer Soderberg before the shot clock goes off, and the 9th turnover in the first half. They're 2 away from their season average already. Been tough for Miami, Ohio in the offensive end, especially their leading scorer, Michael Bramos, who's just been unable to get free on the outside. Wellington Smith has guarded him. Butler shot a little bit long and a foul on the floor.
West Virginia foul was number 35, Wellington Smith.
Well, they're going to get Wellington on that foul, his second foul.
Well, defensively, I mean, they're lined up on the floor right now. You have Deshaun Butler, who is 6'7". He's running your point. Okay, he's 6'7". Alex Rudolph at 6'6" is your 2 guard. Then you have Wellington Smith at 6'7", your 3. Devin Ebanks, 6'9", and John Flowers, 6'7", also on the court. So, I mean, when these guys are here, it allows them to be so active defensively. I mean, look at their wingspan. They can cover so much ground so quickly just by their long wingspan.
You see the points off turnovers for West Virginia. The reason Miami, Ohio doesn't have any points off turnovers, well, they haven't forced a turnover yet. Bramos, tough shot, gets it to fall.
Well, listen, if you're Bobby Huggins, you'll take shots like that from Ramos all day long. There was a guy right there, Rudolph, had a hand in his face, but great awareness and great shot and concentration by Ramos.
His first bucket of the day, he's now 1 for 5 from the field. Ebanks now at the top of the key. Just everybody for West Virginia moving on offense. Butler for 3. Got it.
When they got that on a down screen from Ebanks, Miami not having the communication to switch on those screens allowed our guy, Mr. Deshaun Butler, to get open and knock down a J.
Butler 3 for 5 in the early going. Largest lead of the game for West Virginia.
And talking about Miami, just looks confused right now. I mean, nothing's coming easy. You see the shot right there. It was a little forced. Not getting wide open looks. West Virginia's covering a lot of ground.
Let's take on the Drake Bulldogs. College basketball and Holiday Hoops presented by K Jewelers on ESPNU today. Stolen away by Bramos, 3-on-1 back the other way. Stolen back by Rudolph. Ball bouncing out of bounds. Miami, Ohio will keep it.
Just a lot of sloppy play right there. Alex Rudolph, I think, got fouled. We're talking about games. You're talking about your team. You got Syracuse versus Memphis today.
Big game tonight.
Big game for the Cougs.
Biggest non-conference game of the year so far for Syracuse. That's saying something considering that they beat Florida and Kansas in the CBI Classic, or the CBE Classic, excuse me.
Well, what's the buzz on campus? You know, now you talk about Johnny Flynn has a little lingering injury that, you know, he's probable for today. What are kids talking about?
The buzz is that this is a good team that, when healthy, that can absolutely get back to the NCAA tournament. Offensive foul, we'll see who it's on. But for Syracuse, have a big game tonight at that shocking loss to Cleveland State with a three-quarter court shot in the Carrier Dome. But Eric Devendorf is suspended right now. It originally was for the entire year. He went to the Board of Appeals. That sentence has been reduced by a faculty board. And it can be reduced to 6 games if he does about 40 hours of community service or so. So that is good news for the Orange.
You got to think about how special that team could be if Dante Green decided to stay in school and come back and play.
Talked about the turnovers for Miami, Ohio. They've had 22 possessions. And even Jacket Butler falls down and gets it to go anyway. And he'll go to the line for the and-one opportunity.
Well, listen, these guys had about a 3.5 to 4 hour practice yesterday. And Bobby Huggins got in everybody possible. And one player in particular that I think he really likes is Deshaun Butler. Not being 6'8", he has the ability to put the ball down on the ground, can drive by it, but he can also has a very nice jump shot and can knock it down from the perimeter. And when he plays well, this team plays well. And in their game against Davidson, obviously nobody was able to stop, you know, the babyface killer, like you call him, you know, Stephen Curry. And Rajwell wasn't playing, but Deshaun Butler had a great game, 24 points, 14 rebounds. And I really think he is the underrated leader of this team. He just needs to be more vocal and tell people where to go at the right times.
24-point lead for the Mountaineers, a 16-2 run over the last 6 minutes of play. Miami, Ohio has struggled on either end. Rodney Haddix's into the game at guard with the ball right now. The sophomore, 6'3 guard. Soderberg spots up for three, no good. And Ruoff with a little bit of a stint running the point into Jones in the corner, in and out.
Miami just hasn't been able to find an offensive rhythm. Their main guy, Bramos, hasn't been able to knock down. He's only knocked down one jump shot so far.
Haddix now in the corner. Can't get it to go. We see Alex Ruoff running the point a little bit. We've seen Truck Bryant for most of this game running the point, not on the floor right now. And West Virginia has not missed a beat at point guard so far. Ruoff can't get it to go. Offensive rebound again. The freshman, Kevin Jones.
Well, that's where they're going to have to excel in Big East play. They shoot a lot of threes, but when you talk about going against the likes of Louisville, UConn, Pitt with Blair down low, Louisville with Smarto Samuels, UConn with Hasheem Thabeet. West Virginia does a great job with everybody being around 6'5", 6'6", 6'7", getting on the glass and boxing out. They show you've been able to do it a couple times this year, and they're just showing you how dominant they could be on the boards today. They wait until the shot clock dwindles down to get a backdoor cut or to get a penetration and kick. But what you've seen is that West Virginia has been able to take them out of their style. They're taking step back jump shots now. You have Bramos trying to force the issue because he can't find his offensive rhythm. West Virginia doing a great job defensively, just being, you know, causing a lot of chaos for Miami of Ohio.
Tough pass underneath by Durkers and knocked away again. 12th turnover for Miami, Ohio. Flowers back the other way, gets the foul and the roll. Another 3-point opportunity for West Virginia.
Well, Flowers, just with that strong presence, can drive down the lane and just have the maturity and the strength to finish with the best of them.
4 points for Flowers. He'll try and make it 5 when we get back. Coach Coles does not feel good on that sideline. Tough going for Miami, Ohio against the Mountaineers. Half so far, 40-12 over the Redhawks with 3:35 to play in the first half. And a big reason for that margin has been the 3-point shooting, or lack thereof, from Miami, Ohio. You see the graphic. Over 50% from the field as Flowers gets the 3-point play to go. This is a team, Jay, that came into this game 5th in the nation as a team in 3-point shooting, with Bramos and Kenny Hayes, who's out today with a wrist injury, both shooting over 50% from 3, and as a team, 7th in the nation. Very uncharacteristic of this Redhawks team so far this year.
Well, Bramos is 0-for-4, and a lot of shots he's taken has been contested. And you got to think, he's a second-half player. He's done it in the second half in a lot of games this year. You know, he had 21 of his 26 points in the second half against Temple. He's also had 26 of his 31 points in the second half against Northwestern. So I know it's 40-12 now, 41-12, excuse me. But you hope he can have a huge second half in order to get his team back in this ballgame.
Offensive foul for Miami, Ohio. Isaiah Carson called for the charge. Cam Thurman into the game, number 2 for West Virginia, with the ball now at the top of the key.
And so far for Miami, that's 13 turnovers. And talk about WVU capitalizing. They've scored 19 points off turnovers so far.
Ruoff working in the low post double team, but draws the foul anyway. He'll go to the line to shoot 2.
Well, that's the advantage of Alex Ruoff right there, being 6'5". With a smaller guy on him, he can take you in the perimeter and knock down Jays. And also, if you put somebody smaller on, you can take you in the post. A little mouse in the house action going on down there.
Yeah, you want to put in perspective how important he's been to this team as he knocks down the first free throw. That start he missed against Davidson because of the shoulder and also the rib injury snapped a streak of 80 straight starts for Alex Ruoff. Gives you a little bit of idea of how important he has been as the only senior on this West Virginia team this year.
Well, he needs to be the leader of this team. When you have so many good freshmen that are very, very much talented, as you see Miami make another turnover right there.
14th turnover.
The main question for this team is, who's going to be the guy that's going to put West Virginia on their back? All right, Joe Alexander did that all last year. He put this team on their back. Is it going to be Deshaun Butler? Is it going to be Alex Ruoff? That's a question yet to be determined.
There's Ruoff right there, gets the jumper to fall. That's 11 points for Alex Ruoff in the first half. 25-2 run for West Virginia. Doing it on both ends of the court, forcing turnovers, getting to the bucket on offense, and also hitting from three. Bramos, right on cue, hits a three of his own, his first one of the game. And head coach Charlie Cole's hoping that gets his leading scorer going a little bit here.
Well, this is a situation for Miami where they need some fight. They need somebody to do something to cause some energy. Their energy looks really down. And, you know, we used to have it all the time happen in college. You come out, sometimes you're a little lackluster. You don't bring the energy that you should bring out from the get-go. And it takes maybe for your coach to get a technical foul, somebody to get a hard foul, just get your team pumped up. Maybe this is what Bramos needs to do right now.
Did that get you pumped up as a player, Jay? Let me ask you, when your team was down at Duke's, it wasn't very often, but when your team was down at Duke and, say, Coach K got a technical, was that something that got the team fired up?
It was. It was a chance for you guys to gather your composure, get in a huddle, and just have some communication, understand, all right, you know, we missed a couple of shots, but let's find a way to claw and fight our way back into this ball game. And that's what every team goes through. Every team is going to be down at some point. But it's really your perseverance, your ability to fight through adversity that really shows you the character of your squad. And so far, Miami is not showing that much fight to them.
Ramos with that last miss puts him at 2-for-8 now. Kevin Jones from beyond the arc. Off the front of the rim, rebounded by Ramos, and the fans wanted a foul on that loose ball. Richburg now the starting point guard for Miami, Ohio, with the ball trying to create in the lane. He's going to pull it back out.
Even if you look at Miami defensively, nobody's really talking, nobody's being active. It's kind of like everybody's a zombie on the basketball court.
Richburg again into the lane, throws it right to Kevin Jones underneath the bucket. The turnovers continue for the Redhawks, now under a minute to play in the first half. Another offensive foul. 45-15 West Virginia in a timeout from the Mountaineers. And coming up at halftime, we'll take a look at the top big men in the country and maybe the best conference not only this year, but maybe in the history of college basketball in the Big East with all the ranked teams they have. 8, it's a record. And also we'll take a look at the first half stats and highlights from this game here in Morgantown.
I think there's a lot of big games today. You talk about your Q's going against Memphis. You talk about UConn against Gonzaga out in Seattle. Duke against Xavier, a really good Xavier team with C.J. Anderson, Derrick Brown. I think the one question for Duke is, will he be able to rebound when it counts? We've seen a lot of games going against Michigan. Deshaun Sims, a lot of those guys, Gibson, had their way against Duke on
non-conference games. Xavier out of the A-10. Made a great run to the Elite Eight last year, trying to put together another big season again. 20 seconds to play in the first half, about a 5-second differential between the game and shot clock. West Virginia with a 30-point lead, trying to add to that. Allen throws it down. Kevin Jones one-handed.
Mr. Jones, Mr. Jones, Mr. Jones.
Richburg with 1 second left, feeds it underneath and does not get the shot off. There is a foul underneath the bucket.
I don't know if it's going to count.
We'll see. It looked like the contact came after the buzzer went off. Bob Huggins is already walking off the court with his team, and Looks like the referees are going to talk about this, maybe go to the monitor at the scorer's table to see if the foul happened before the clock hit zero.
Well, I love the action beforehand. I love the screener action. You see Ruoff comes off the screen and they hit Kevin Jones with the back screen. Well, you see the play right here. And you wonder if it's a foul. There's nothing. Well, it looks like the light was on.
We might have to take another look at that. That was very close. It was bang, bang, and referees are over checking out the monitor at the scorer's table right now. Our referees today, Mike Pitts, Frank Scagliotta, and Jeff Clark, and see if they can sort this out at the end. That's maybe a little body with Cam Thurman's leg on the hip.
Well, I think the body happened as the red light was coming on.
Let's take a look.
See right there, the red light goes off before the body contact even happens.
So it looks like that last replay really gave us a good look at it. It looks like this shouldn't be a foul because the clock hit zero initially.
But they're gonna give it to him. They're gonna put him on the line, give him two shots.
They are. No time on the clock. They should clear out the lane unless they put more time on the clock. We'll see what they do. Tyler Durker's on the line. He is Miami, Ohio's best free throw shooter at 86%. And they did put 0.1 seconds back onto the clock, so players will stay in the lane.
Well, that dunk was an amazing pass by Ruoff right here to come off the screen of screener action. And you saw Jones just showing you with his frame, with his size, the ability to finish on top of people. A little earth for you.
Second free throw, good, 0.1 seconds, and that'll do it. A 30-point lead led by Alex Ruoff, and the Mountaineers have come out after a week off for finals and taken a 47-17 lead at the half. All Mountaineers here in Morgantown, West Virginia, coming up at halftime. Stick around, we have highlights, and we'll take a look at some of the big men, the top big men in the country.